Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I would like to welcome everyone to what is the final session of what has been a fabulous conference. I think we all need to kind of give it up for Joe Shora and the Calandra people. Really been a great time. The challenge has been in the sessions that are running at the same time, trying to figure out which ones to get to. But it really has been quite fabulous. And this last session, I assume, will be no different. Our last session is entitled Consuming Italian Through Food. Did you think we could get through a conference on material objects without getting to the food part? So of course not. Exactly. Oh, and we do have a little surprise for you. So that's actually very true. Our first speaker today, Jacqueline Maggio-May, is a nonprofit administrator and an interdisciplinary scholar. She completed her PhD in comparative studies with a focus on history, ethnic studies, and media studies from Florida Atlantic University in 2014. Her background in the museum and education fields fuels her passion for history, foodways, the design of everyday objects, and anthropology. Her dissertation, Americans All, The Role of Media in Reimagining Ethnicity in America, The Case of the World War II War Advertising Council, explores identity construction and historically what it meant to be the other in America. Jackie, the descendant of Italian immigrants, is passionate about history, lore, and traditions of her ancestors. A New Yorker by birth, she now resides in St. Petersburg, Florida, where she is director of learning initiatives for the Florida Humanities Council, the state affiliate of the National Endowment for the Humanities. In this capacity, she designs and facilitates numerous cultural heritage programs on subjects including the history of Florida's diverse peoples. Her paper entitled, Take the Cannoli, The Commodification of Italian and Italian-American Culture at Mazzaro Italian Market, St. Petersburg, Florida. So therefore, you understand completely that whenever possible, she enjoys a good cannoli. Without further ado, Jackie.
Good afternoon, everybody. Can you hear me okay in the back?
Yeah.
Great. I fully understand, and I believe my co-panelists do, that we are the only thing standing between you and happy hour. So Donna is going to keep us on time. If you would dim the lights for me, please, we could get started. Thank you. Like individuals migrating from one place to another, objects, including artifacts and artistic productions, find new meaning, purpose, and identities over time and space. This presentation will explore what happens when seemingly random collections of objects evolve into shrine-like or museum-like experiences, spaces where imagined Italian or Italian-American pasts have been brought to life in a smorgasbord for the senses. Tampa Bay, Florida has been home to immigrants for over 150 years. Early immigrants to the seaport community included Cubans, Spaniards, and Italians coming to work in the region's growing agricultural and cigar industries. Immigrant enclaves thrived, and fraternal societies such as Florida's first Sons of Italy Lodge emerged as vibrant bastions of culture and community for the immigrants. And if I can figure out how to work the pointer, here we have the beautiful Italian American Club, which has been preserved and is still standing in that community. And I'll just go over briefly the Italian role in this part of Florida, and then we'll move on to the good stuff. While exotic ethnic others in Florida, particularly in Tampa Bay, resided as they did elsewhere in the United States, primarily in immigrant enclaves. In Tampa, the region was Ybor City. Culture was more widely accepted by Florida's dominant culture via commodities such as architecture, crafts, and the arts. And here you can see a couple of examples of some well-known Florida Italian-inspired, or if you really were an architect, you would know that this is probably more Spanish architecture, but who's counting? Another way well, American author Bell Hooks refers to cultural commodification literally as eating the other. And we can really see how that can take place. She really means that cultural expressions can be sold, in a sense, to the dominant culture. Mm-hmm. What cultural critic Marina Torgovinek describes as flirting with other ways of experiencing the universe. So another way that I look at that is food. Food is a distant yet safe way to experience diverse cultures. You can put it down and walk away from it. It doesn't necessarily, you don't have to confront it. It's something that you can experience on your own terms. So in as much, one could say that that is how America came to, or certain communities in America came to first truly experience the Italian in their communities. So foods which had been considered distinctly Italian and exotic became a conduit for Americans to enter this strange and exotic Italian-American world while still clinging to stereotypes, as Michelle Fazio referenced in her talk, that whole notion of spaghetti was sort of a stereotypical thing. This was an exotic sort of experience for the non-Italian members of the community. So this is an article from 1947 in the Tampa Sunday Tribune, where they're showing how one eats spaghetti, because it's this exotic thing that one might not be able to comprehend on their own. We move on here, the Spaghetti Palace of St. Petersburg, and this was in 1948. The Spaghetti Palace jester entertains the patrons, and then MacDill Air Force Base, which was still is a very large military installation in Tampa Bay. Here they were bringing some of the troops and visiting dignitaries out to taste the famous spaghetti of Tampa. And you know, a few years later, it's 1954 that Joe DiMaggio marries this woman, you might have heard of Marilyn Monroe, and they actually honeymooned in St. Petersburg. That combined with businesses emerging, such as Tropicana Orange Juice, which many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with, was founded by a Tampa resident named Antonio Rossi in 1954. So it's not just that in Tampa Bay, Italians are becoming, are emerging as respected members of the community. There's an Italian-American mayor, but yet there's this air of exoticism. This is something I learned yesterday. I was very excited to hear this from fellow presenter Denise Scanelli Guida. Her family from Tampa, for several generations, she shared with me that they still go to this restaurant, which still exists in Tampa, for special occasion dinners and the like. Here, we have examples of the emergence of the Italian community in Tampa as it relates specifically to foodways. And as I understand it from my research, the majority of patrons for these businesses would have been the immigrants of the community. Now, this is where it starts to get interesting. This is from 1930, from the Tampa Morning News. And while the average Tampa resident, including Italian Americans or anybody of an ethnic heritage, could walk into the average supermarket, here you'll find some interesting things. First of all, what I really like about this is you've got a hybridity of the language. You've got the El Progresso Emporium, Italian American grocery, and one of the featured items, guava paste, which is a staple among the Cuban community and culinary tradition. So there's clearly this appreciation, understanding, and community among the immigrants in this area. Now, fast forward, while memories are stored in our hearts and minds, and some might argue our stomachs, they are evoked through the conduit of material culture, the objects, creations, and constructions of human expression. When material cultural objects and artifacts are successful, they evoke a memory and sometimes enable the reader or audience to make connections to their identity, whether that is real or imagined. Such is the case at Mazzaro's Market in St. Petersburg, Florida. If Walt Disney were still alive today, he could take a lesson from Mazzaro's in how to depict a culture. This place makes Epcot look like, you know, amateur time. And actually, a little side note, Joe Shora and his wife were vacationing in Florida this past fall for a lovely beach getaway, and it rained every day they were in town, so we chatted, and I said, among other things, you should go to this Italian market. And he said, I'm from Brooklyn, why do I need to go to an Italian market? And I said, go. And within an hour, he starts texting me pictures, and I'm talking about you, Joe.
Yeah.
So
that's better curated than the Italian-American Museum.
And that's part of the conversation. So that said, this market, with its faux stonework and other elements, its religious statuary and iconography, a collection of vintage Italian automobiles, is intended to appear as if it's a 75-year-old marketplace with various experiences to be had. Here, you can see, I mean, they've gone as far as to have a little cutout. You can stand back there and put your head. I should have had Joe and his wife pose for that one for me. The proprietors are Italian Americans. They are transplants to the Tampa Bay area from Pittsburgh. They established a collection of objects into a visual spectacle that simultaneously delights the senses and transports one back to an imagined Italian / Italian American past. The company started as a coffee roasting business, and thus it is in a very industrial warehouse community, and it has expanded from this primary original building that you see here to two full city blocks. So it's really quite an impressive compound. They still roast their own coffee and things of that nature. Many homemade items are available there. When they opened back in 1992, what I've read, they were not available for comment at all, despite my great efforts. But I've read that they never anticipated the growth of what they've had. And so what they've done in taking over these two large blocks, they needed ample parking. They decided, I'm assuming, to use every square inch of the property that they own. So there is something everywhere you turn. This is the entrance to the statuary garden. To me, it evokes entering a cemetery of sorts. And here you could see the statuary, which is sort of randomly placed, but very inviting, and you'll see patrons sitting outside enjoying their coffee and their pastries or their sandwiches. So it's truly, this is just the outside. And there are people that live in the residences across the street that have their own statues. They're trying to sort of compete with the market. Upon entering Mazzaro's, you'll see that immediately, this is walking right through the front door, you're entering a creatively curated environment where object-driven memories create unique experiences. And truly, everywhere you look, from the floor to the ceiling, there is something. And if you have, of course, you know, the icons of our culture directly above the produce case. With its various zones or districts, the proprietors have created a sense of adventure, of wonder, akin to exploring a central market of Europe or an American urban center, or even, in my perception, an amusement park of sorts. Throughout the market, as we continue on our little journey here, you will see in every corner there's a shrine, a display, but as you could see here, they are not just solitary, they're over the wine section here, are the cases of wine. Here, where we have the personal care items, your organic balms, lotions, essential oils, you also have this rather intricate shrine set up. And again, in the wine section, we have a tribute to what I would imagine is a beloved family member. Here, we can see, again, everywhere you look, there is something, and they've done a fine job of creating these distinctive environments. You will note that the customer profile has expanded as well. It's no longer a market frequented primarily by Italian-American householders. On a given weekday, men in shirt sleeves and ties line up at the counter to order lunch alongside homemakers placing their orders for Sunday supper ingredients, or tourists wandering the aisles seeking the perfect vantage point for taking in the detailed and memory-evoking scene, even if the memory is not their own. And here is just an example. This was if you get there at Saturday at, you know, like 9 o'clock when they open, you can actually see the counter. By 9:15, there it's 4 to 5 people deep. It's amazing. Here, they are marketing and monopolizing on their own success, where you've got all of your Mazzaro's merchandise, including the giant mustaches. And they also, at a festival, they're very active in the community. They recently had a t-shirt that said, "Legalize Marinara," which I thought was rather entertaining. So they're quite current, and they're very active in the Tampa Bay community. On my last field study, which is when I go to get coffee and pastry on Saturdays, during the height of snowbird season on one Saturday morning, it seemed to me that I was the only Italian-American in the venue. Several of the individuals I spoke with at the coffee bar were Canadian, who went there daily while they were on vacation, some folks from the Midwest, and even a couple from England. So it's not that I would say people plan their travel around this venue, but it has certainly become a must-see spot in the community. Here we have the wine cellar, and I put this shot in not because it's really such a great shot, but if you look at the arches and the shrine-like creations or curations in the background, you know, you've got your fluorescent light here. I mean, you clearly, you're in a supermarket. Despite everything else that's going on around you, it is a functional space. The all-important bakery, and you could sit, this is my seat at the coffee bar, watching the magic being made behind the scenes. And here, they're not taking themselves too seriously, which is always important. So it really serves as an example of not just how a diasporic community emerged into the dominant culture in Tampa Bay, but also an expression of the story objects can tell, even if that story is comprised to an extent of objects of stereotype. For example, the Mazzaro's merchandise, the murals, and so forth, the manufactured memories, or, you know, even for those who are not Italian American, you saw the icons, the Frank Sinatra, the Dean Martin, so people are getting the sense that they're, oh, this is a real thing, this is real Italian American culture. Here is the back patio, again, that they've knocked out through the back wall, and this is where you can enjoy your sandwich or your lunch, complete with the beautiful statuary again. Here is the latest incarnation, so they've expanded out into yet another building, and this is a three-dimensional entranceway to what is now called the Casa di Mazzaro, which is a high-end housewares depot featuring objects ranging from coffee roasters to placemats. Interestingly, within this space, which I did not get a decent photograph of, it's very dark, there is none of the curatorial aspect. I don't know if that's because it's a newer space that's recently opened and they haven't had time yet to develop that. My instinct is that they're deliberately not doing that. They don't want to detract from the merchandise that's available for sale, because within this structure, they are selling objects versus consumable, edible items. So that's something that we could debate. In closing, as the description for this conference stated, objects exist, they circulate, and are interpreted within different regimes of value, including the world of commodities. Here, we have seen how objects are used to communicate, to establish sensory experiences and evoke memories and identities that may never even have been. And I love this image, Ralph Fasanella's painting. It's evocative for me in ways in which food and other material objects help develop identity. So here we've got the food ways, the family table, and the objects not unlike those that we saw during our time together in Mazzaro's. Thank you.
I curated an exhibition on the history of Tropicana.
Oh, wonderful.
And so Antonio Rosso, it was interesting to me, the articles you sent about the spaghetti, because I don't know if you already know that he tried to market a spaghetti sauce.
I did not know that.
And that did not take off. Tropicana took over. But simply the fact that spaghetti was becoming a cultural thing in that area,
yes,
and he latched on to it to try to develop the spaghetti sauce, which he did sell for a while.
But he had access to more oranges in that area.
That is a story.
Well, two things. One is just a funny comment, but I'm sure you know about this, but maybe not everybody in the room will. You know, of course, that in the UK, the most famous April Fool's joke that was ever played, that there is this tradition that on April Fool's Day, the main newspapers in the UK play some kind of joke. So it's on the front page of The Guardian, The Times, or whatever. And the one that's remained famous over the years, and I think it was the late 50s or the very early 60s, was the spaghetti tree. You know about that? So it was the picture of Italians collecting, you know, sort of harvesting spaghetti from the spaghetti tree.
Oh, yes.
So that, just to put that in context. But what I wanted to ask you about, on the other hand, is how does this relate to the kind of fake Italian architecture and you know, the huge reproductions of villages, et cetera, we're seeing increasingly, you know, whether it's Disney World, et cetera, from Japan to South Africa to the U.S. You know, is there any relationship between
these? I honestly don't believe in this particular case that there is. I think that this emerged, you know, in 1992, it's a warehouse. They're roasting coffee. It's a fairly utilitarian space. You could see that from the basic metal structure of the buildings. I think that over time, the family or people in the community just started bringing in things, or they would pick up things here and there. I don't believe when they first opened, it was not this. So I don't think it was open with that intention of this grand spectacle, if you will, or even to create this false identity. Coincidentally, and maybe this will give us a clue, the family owned another restaurant in St. Petersburg called the 4th Street Shrimp Store, it's a tongue twister. And in that space, it was a historic building that they took over, and over time, and I know this from speaking to patrons that frequent it for the last 40 years, that developed over time as well. So this is not like a TGI Fridays or a Walt Disney event where they go in wholesale and boom, it's done. They continue to add things.
Question on spaghetti.
Yes, sir. It's delicious.
Marco Polo went to the Far East, right?
Yes.
And he discovered that the Chinese had spaghetti. And, thank you. And he brought it back to Israel. And yet all the time, including myself, we love spaghetti and we're meatball.
We do.
Is that true?
I can't speak for everybody in this room, but I can certainly assure you that in my family, it was a priority.